having done nothing wrong or even illegal in their society, but just having made false reactions. And he wasn't there for a week. He wasn't there for a month. He wasn't even there for a year. He was there for years. A jail. A prisoner. And in that state, he said, you just have to enjoy it. Now that's tough, isn't it? It's not typically a human reaction. It is a godly reaction. That's why God calls us to be something more than just a typical human. He calls us to be godly. That godliness practiced by us. And one of those things is to exclaim God is great at all times. No matter what we are suffering, no matter what we are going through, to understand, to have the blessing, to know, no matter what is happening, God is great. Because not only has He provided for me all that I need, He has given to me a future, a brighter future, and a glorious hope. So that no matter what is happening, my future is always better. Even when things are great. Even when I think this is just the best life can be. People talk about living their best life. The truth is, you have not lived your best life, and you never will live your best life as long as you're in the world. Your best life is to come. You believe that. You know that. And when you know that, when you trust that, when you believe it, God is great. All the time. Hard to do, hard to remember, but it's one of those growth things for us to get and not be merely human. So let's look at the passages here about rejoicing and being glad. Jesus said in John 15, verse 11, to his apostles that night, and this is right before they went out into the garden, and he said the prayer, and they were with him, and then he was arrested. Just before that, he told them in John 15, 11, these things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy may be full. So Jesus talks about having joy at that moment. Now, this is just before the passage that Mark spoke of, where Jesus is praying, may this cup pass from me. Did his joy go up and did his joy leave him? No. Did his joy there somehow and not there overnight? He always had joy. Even on the cross, he spoke of the glory that was to come. He looked forward to seeing God again and being in His presence again. And so He spoke these things. He taught them for 3 years. When He says that, these things I've spoken to you, He spoke a lot to them that night. We can go there in John, starting in chapter 13. We get to see a lot of things that He spoke to them that night. But I don't think He was talking about just that night. I think He was talking about everything He had ever taught them. I have taught all these things to you. I have spoken all these things to you so that your joy will be full. Because that is the end result of somebody who believes and who practices godliness. Because joy comes from godliness. It doesn't come from being a kid. It comes from godliness. And so, listening to the words of God, hearing the words of God, that's what's necessary for us. That's what's important for us in order to truly have the joy that He wants us to have. In 1 John chapter 1, verse 4, John wrote, he says, the things that he was writing to them in his letter. These things we write to you, that your joy may be full. Now, notice what he says, we write to you. Now, is he referring to somebody helping to write it? Or is he referring to what all the apostles were doing and all their letters that they sent to everybody? Because we are helping you have joy and have it be full. Not have a little bit, It goes back to that idea of Psalm 23, that your joy isn't something that you've got, you know, maybe half full, or you got a little bit here, got a little bit there. It is overflowing. That's what Psalm 23 talks about, right? When the shepherd watching over us, our cup is not just half full. It's not just all the way full. It is overflowing. It's more than I can even handle or deserve. 1 Peter chapter 1. This is the passage I'd like you to turn with me. If you've got your Bibles there or your app or whatever, to read these passages. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verses 3 through 9. Now, you know when Peter writes his letters, the churches are actually at a time where they are beginning to suffer. The difficulties of being a Christian are beginning to mount. Even in 1 Peter, 2 Peter, he really addresses it expressly about the suffering that they're going through. But in 1 Peter, it's already happening. He refers to, I would just probably tell you, all the Christians, and calling them exiles who are in dispersion. We are not home. We are cast away from our homeland. That's the idea of being exiled. It's also the idea of the Hebrew term of the dispersion. That was a term that referred to all the Jews who didn't get to live around Jerusalem, who were cast off into other countries, you know, that had to live under foreign rule and didn't have kind of a Hebrew or Israel leadership. They were the dispersion. That began to happen back in the 720s, 730, when the 10 tribes of Israel fell and were dispersed all over the three continents, really. And he's talking to them. This is who he's writing to. People who are exiles, who are dispersed from the home. And he says, starts off with verse 3, and this is the word that's probably best connected with the idea of joy, and that is blessed. That's what joy really is. It's an understanding of knowing you're blessed. It's not the emotion of feeling you're happy. It's the knowledge of knowing your blessed. It says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. All that sounds really great, right? It's all wonderful. It's all good. It's like, right, got inheritance. Can nobody can ever steal it from me. No emperor, no king, no dictator can ever take it from me. God has your inheritance set aside for you, more than you can ever imagine, more than you ever deserve. And he says, nobody can ever touch it. It's yours. And he says, we are being guarded by God's power that at the last time it will all be revealed about what we're doing. And he says in the beginning of verse 6, in this you rejoice. It's like, wow, yes, I'm rejoicing in all this wonderful stuff. Except he goes from there to go, now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials. Okay, you've been thrown in jail, you've been beaten. They don't seem that little, right? They don't seem that small. See, the reality is what he's describing as little is bigger than anything you and I probably have ever gone through. Some of the songs we looked at spoke of, you know, suffering and how people endured the difficulties to be with God. Well, you and I, having grown up in this country, have not endured many difficulties for God. A handful, we might have caused more of our own difficulties than we brought upon us because we believe in God in this country. It really isn't that hard. And almost anything you can come up with, we go, yeah, it kind of pales in comparison to what they went through in the early centuries. Because you begin to describe what happened to them. Not only did they attack people directly, they grabbed their family members. They killed their children because they believed in God. They did things that you and I, and you know what most of the Christians did when they acted? They sang songs of praise. One of the things that impacted Roman, especially Roman soldiers, Roman soldiers were often impacted by the reaction of Christians to being killed. So one of the things that helped overthrow, without fighting, Christians ultimately won, obviously because of God's power. But they did it because they were full of joy, even when he killed my family. Because they understood, well, my family just got to go to heaven a little quicker. But you killed me. I just need to go to heaven a little quicker. You can't make it worse for me. You can torture me. You can make it hard. You can give me problems. But you cannot take away my joy. Because my future is already assured by God, and there's nothing they can do about it. That's what they did. That's what they understood. It's how they have joy in the midst of all the persecution. And so, he says, oh yeah, you've got to have a few little sufferings in there. Maybe you go to jail for a little while. Maybe you get a few whips and glasses on. Yeah, a few whips to kind of bandage it out. After a little while, maybe it'll happen for, you know, 3-4 decades. Nothing to worry about. Right? That's a little while. Because how long is a little while to God? Well, a lot longer than yours in my life. So sometimes a little while can be the rest of your life. Ah, oh, that's not the big deal. It's only going to be a little while. Just thought that. But he says, for a little while now, if necessary, you've been grieved by various trials, so that to test the genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. That's what he said. Notice what he said there. That the result of these various trials, these persecutions, these difficulties, is praise and glory and honor. And that's what the early Christians do. And you can read a lot of historical letters of God, right? And there's an abundance of them. And the things that people went through, and the things they said, and sometimes, there's a letter in a Christian history magazine I have that always struck me. A fairly young woman who has some little children who's arrested because of her faith. Her parents don't agree in her faith. They are not Christians. And they want her to renounce her faith so she can raise her children. And she writes a letter basically talking about the joy of Christ and how her children will be okay. God will provide for them no matter what happens to me. And she talks about dying and dying with joy. And most of you and I would have trouble with that, wouldn't we? We would struggle with what she was facing. And she went through it. And I remember writing the second century kind of thing of the letter. She'd been arrested, she'd been imprisoned, that may be killed. And she's like, okay. It'll be great. I'm trying to trust God. Because you know what? God could be more to my children than I can. Do we believe that? I'm not sure we always believe that. We sometimes think we are the most important person in our children's lives as parents. Now, we certainly are some of the most important human beings in their life, and probably the most important. But we're not the sole dictator of their lives. God is far more powerful than you and I, even as parents. And so, no matter whether our parents raise us away from God, don't know anything about God, like Mark talked about, or I've gone through it, whether our parents have hated the idea of God, or hated it, lots of people have overcome this. Lots of children have gone beyond God and can see and learn for themselves. But he says in verses 8 and 9, just by the end there, though you have not seen him, you love him. But you do not see him, you believe in him, and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Notice he says you can't even express the joy. that it's not, you know, like, I'm not even happy. That's something that we express. We see it in the face, right? We see people smiling. Oh, wow, they're just so happy. We see people in their actions, in their behavior, we can see happiness. What we don't often see, even is joy, blessing, the idea of being fulfilled. I think your father shows up more in the idea of contentment and peace than it does in their basic life. The idea of joy is so grand and so big that it's only, you can't even see it. That's what he's telling us. I want to talk, a great quote I saw about, if you have no joy, there's a leak in your Christianity somewhere. That's a really great way of putting that concept. You know, I was just kind of looking for, you know, search around the internet for some image and idea of things that just suck the joy from people. And it's like, yeah, it's leaking somewhere. Where's the leak? I've got to patch it up so my joy is full. Right? That's what John wrote. That's what Jesus said. My joy is supposed to be full. There's no reason it can't be full. So if it's not full, something's causing it to leak. And I got to pass that. So, and I'm not going to read a lot of these passages, by the way. I think you'll know some of them. Many of you may jot them down, go look at them. I've done lots of other lessons about these in more detail. But the enemies of joy. And I think at first what we really understand, worry, anxiety, fear, they really kill children. And I think that's completely understandable to everybody. I think almost every human being, whether you're Christians or not, understand the idea that it's hard to be joyful when you are full of anxiety, fear, or worry. And Jesus talks about that. Matthew 6 there, Matthew 8. And even Paul talks about it in Philippians 4, which we'll look at in a little bit. But the idea, and the Proverbs talk about it as well, by the way. Psalms talk about it a little bit. How worry, anxiety, fear, they can drive us, distract from us. The joy that God wants us to understand we have. And so, that's one of the areas that I think we kind of all get and understand. The second one, I think, is maybe a little bit more contrary, especially young people. Very often when we're young, we think if we get everything we desire, we're going to be happy and blessed and live, you know, for the rest of our lives, you know, like old fairy tales, you know, modern fairy tales. Talk about how they live, you know, happy lives with their, you know, forever. Well, the old fairy tales didn't say that. Because all the modern fairy tales that Disney has taken from old fairy tales that had a real dark side to them, because they were moral stories for children written by adults with real maturity going, you know what? Life's hard. And if you're not careful, you're going to get stuck in the darkness. That was most of the point of the fairy tales. They had really dark ages, you know, the children caught in the woods with, you know, the woman who wants to cook up, but she actually does in the real story. Well, sorry Disney, I wouldn't like that. We want to have happily ever after. Well, that's not real true, not real life. And very often, when we get everything we ever wanted, we're talking about the desires of the flesh. We are not happier or better. We are often driven by desires, and those desires don't help us. They don't improve us. They don't make our lives better. And you go all the way back to the very idea of eating fruit. That, if you look at, I don't know how people love fruit. I don't love fruit. I don't find fruit. Some fruit I like better than others. Yeah. But, I mean, I'm like, I don't ever have a point in my life where I just like half a fruit. I eat it. I enjoy it. I don't know if strawberries are good when I see it, but I don't really have like strong desires for fruit. They have less fruit than vegetables, so even though I eat those too. But I have strong desires for other things. I scream. It doesn't make me feel good. It doesn't help me. I have strong desires for certain things, and I eat that, and I don't feel good about it. It's like, why? And it isn't just, okay, it's unnatural sugar. That's not true. Honey, really the great natural sugar, the great natural sweetener in the world. Scriptures talk about this idea of eating too much honey as well. You eat too much honey, what do you feel like? Feel sick. It's like, it's a lot like, I don't know if when you're a kid, you went to a fair, and it was really hot, because I was in the middle of summer. And you get the big cotton candy, so just pure sugar, just put straight into the Venus model, just, go for the bay. Throw the sugar straight into you. And I don't know if you did it, but I did it a bunch as a kid, going to the fair, going to just all that sugar in your mouth. And then you start riding, you start skating, you say, oh, I know, that's a really good combination. But that's the thing you want, that's the thing you desire. It wasn't good for you. It's exactly what happened to Jesus. And what Satan does, he says that when the things will feel good to you, when you take them, you'll feel better, and you'll be happy, and you'll be smart, and you'll be. And it comes off to your body. Scripture talks about it with sex. Sex. Talks about in Proverbs, especially in the early chapters of Proverbs. The first like 9 chapters there, it comes up quite a bit. The idea of sex comes up and it says it's going to make you feel great. This is going to make everything better. It's personified, by the way, in the early chapters of Proverbs as a woman who's just enticed a young man. And all it leads is to a pit. A pit of despair. A pit of sorrow. They don't feel that way. They don't look that way. It's never presented that way. The devil doesn't do that. People present on TV or ads sex as the answer to your dreams. All the fulfillment of your desires to make you feel so wonderful. They didn't tell you it only lasts for a moment and then it's gone. But when we're young, we're especially kind of swept up into that. Our bodies are full of that desire, and we think it's just going to make everything right, and it just doesn't. It's just a desire of the flesh. And very often, if your life is about the desire of the flesh, it ends up hurting you. There's a very interesting thing here in Galatians 16:23. I want to look at a couple, just two verses. And I want to point out something in them that I've not even really thought about much before. Maybe you have. In Matthew 16, verse 23, it's a red chapter here. This is the passage where Jesus was telling them that he's going to die. And Peter is like, oh, no, we're not going to let you die. You're the king. You're the Lord. And he's like, get behind me, Satan. He says, you are a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of men. Do you think Peter desired his Lord to die? Do you think Peter wanted his Lord to go to the cross? Would you want anyone or somebody you love to be crucified? No. But was it necessary? Was it important? Was it better for Peter that he was crucified? Jesus knew that. God knew that. People didn't know that. Because he was caught up in the desires of human beings. So even when we have what we think are good intentions, our desires can lead us down the wrong path. The other thing in Galatians 5, and this is a passage probably also where Galatians 5 talks about the fruit of the Spirit as well as the lust to reflect and things. So Galatians chapter 5, verse 17. Another verse that says something that I never really focused a whole lot But there in verse 17, it says, for the desires of the flesh are against the spirit. Okay? I can understand that, right? It says, and the desires of the spirit are against the flesh, for they are opposed to each other, to keep you from doing the things you want to do.
Wait a second. Let's just have a question.
The desires of the flesh are keeping you from doing what you want. If what you want is joy and blessings and love and peace and kindness and goodness and self-control, if you want all that stuff, desires of the flesh are keeping you from it. And that's why Satan wants to, he wants to choke that fire in the flesh. He wants to make you feel like there's more things you need. You're not going to be full. You're not going to be satisfied. You're not going to be content until you've gone and seen that, or you've traveled this, or you have this job, or you have that money, or you have this house, or you have that car. That's all we want. Trying to get us to understand and fall for the trap of Satan, kill the joy, the full joy of being with God. No matter where that takes us, no matter where that is, no matter where we are, no matter how much we have, no matter how nice our clothes, that our joy is full. Because our God is with us. Now, the third one, and I don't know if these are the only ones that exist, by the way, but they are kind of three key things that suck the joy of life. In 1 Timothy, there in chapter 6, he talks a lot about the danger of the love of money, of the desire to be rich. But these two verses, especially in this section that I wanted to kind of focus on a little bit, but those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. It is through this craving that some have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many pains. Listen, so people go and get rich and hurt themselves. Yes, all the time. They think it's going to get better because they're rich. And it doesn't improve their life. It's the trap of the idea of what? The concept of wealth, of riches. How rich is enough? How wealthy does one need to be to feel like that's enough wealth? And most people say, I don't know what you want to see. And you know what? People who make $30 million a year still feel like I can have more. I can get more. I remember hearing my basketball player, he's probably going to get paid somewhere maybe $40 million a year that he's trying to do for the next like 5 years. And I was hearing him talk about his kind of future, his coming contract season. And he was like, people were like, well, what do you want? What? He said, well, I just want to stack up money. Why? Because you want to be a billionaire. But you know, when you're a billionaire, you can buy things with billionaires can't buy. Billionaires can buy things millionaires can't buy. So there's one of the owners of one of the professional football teams, son of Al Davis, Mark Davis, who owns now the Oakland Raiders. And he's worth apparently about $500 million. To you and I, we're like, can you imagine that? The guy flies Southwest, too, gets this weird, stupid haircut out there, but he's like, yo, I'm not going to make that much money. But, you know. He's looked at inside Poverty Row in the NFL. You know, he's the only owner in the NFL who doesn't, who isn't a billionaire. And so they say the owners are in the state, they can't afford stuff, they can't do stuff. Like, the concept of owning a football team in the NFL is not in the stratosphere of 99.99. It's not the 1% that could do that, it's the 0.001% of the world. The same is true in most other professional sports, NFL just being the one of the most expensive. Well, see, when people get so rich, they begin to think of stuff like that. It's like, oh, you know, I got $500 million, but I can't go buy an NFL football team. The only reason Mark Davis has that A on the tour is because his father got it in the 60s when they were very expensive. And he didn't hold it. The $500 million, he couldn't buy into the bank. He sees it. And I bring all that up only to point out there's never rich enough. There's always something else that can be dangled out in front of you, no matter how much you have, that says, well, you know, if you have a little bit more, you can have this. So there's never rich enough. Proverbs and Psalms talk about that idea as well. If there's this concept that you just need more, I just need more, I just need more. How much do you need? When is it enough? That's a hard question to answer. Because almost always we think, if I have a little bit more, I could do this, I could do that. I just need a little bit. And it's a trap. It's an ever-ending hole. Can never be filled. And it sucks the life and the joy. Feeling like, because joy tells us I'm full, right? What does the love of money tell me? I don't have enough. That's what it's all about. And so when we look at all the stuff around us and just wanting more all the time, it sucks the true joy that God has given us from us. It's part of the leak that we have. I'm just going to end with this here. I'm not going to go through the passage, by the way, because again, I taught on this quite a bit in the past while I wrestled about it. In Philippians 4:4, rejoice in the Lord always. That is a command for you and I. Again, I will say, rejoice. Do it. Well, we have it. But Paul, it's like really different. I can't just rejoice. Oh, yeah, but you don't understand. Rejoice. Rejoice. It's telling you, do it. Find it and do it no matter what. That's the thing. And I'm not saying that's easy, by the way. I don't have that down. I don't have that out. I find myself in the same trap as all of us do. You're feeling like, oh, you know, this is not going well, this is not going as I get. No, I'm just going to find it. I'm going to not only find it, because reality, I don't need to find it. I just need to remember it. I already have it. That's the real sad part, is I already have it. I just forgot about it. And so, in verse 5, there's 4 points about how to defeat the enemies. The things that suck joy from us. You've got to remember that the Lord is near. So one of the first things he says right after this, you've got to remember that he is with you. He walks with you. He is with you all the time. And he knows everything you think. He knows every pain you have in your soul. Whether you can express it or not. He understands it. And he understands it better than you ever do. And the second thing, you know, he talks about after that is pray. Pray always. You've got to pray for it. You've got to talk about it. Because, first off, if I remember all the time he's right with me, like, oh, if somebody was sitting with you, and you're like, if you're sitting in the same car, and you drive for a couple of hours in the same car, and you never talk, either of you two guys, who don't care, or if one of you is female, they're thinking something like, because most people don't like to just sit there in silence and not talk. You want to have some kind of expression between you. And so, when you know God is with you, you want to talk with him. And you know he's walking with you. One of the images I started using recently, and I've really enjoyed, and it comes to the idea of being clothed with Christ. The idea of putting on Christ, which actually scriptures talk about, the idea of us being clothed with Christ, because in reality, our real clothing to allow us to be in God's presence is not this fabric. Okay, before God, even with all this fabric, without Christ, we are naked blind, poor. But when Christ is put on, then we're covered to be in God's presence. And the idea that Christ clothes, one thing I think about when I get up in the morning, so just the last couple of weeks, I don't know why it didn't take me a couple of weeks to get up. Every morning, wake up, think about it, putting on Christ. You know, we get up in the morning, right, and put your pants on, put your shirt on, put your clothes on. Before you even do any of that, still at the edge of the bed, concept, just the mental concept of putting on Christ. And I don't know, for me, it's worked wonders for me mentally for a couple of weeks. All right, and hopefully it will continue. But just the concept, the idea, the image, and what it is, all I'm doing is reminding myself of something that's already true. And so, that caused me, I call that idea of, you're with me, you're right here, right, talking with me. And so, it doesn't become just, hey, I've got to go and find some time, and I've got to do these kind of prayers. Praying just means talking about it. Now, there are certain types of prayers, things where you're asking God to help somebody else, where you're praising Him, or there's kind of other types of prayers, but the idea of praying just means talking. And He tells you to tell Him. He says, if He's walking with you and you're talking with Him, this is what happens if two people are close, right? What happens if you drive a couple of hours and something's on your mind and something's been bothering you? What are you going to do for 2 hours driving in your car? Will you probably talk about it if it's on your mind and it's bothering you? Yeah. Because that's what happens. Talk to God. Then He moves into the idea of thinking. You've got to change how we think. Now, a lot of times we don't think we have power over this, that God kind of controls that, but really we can force ourselves to think on the good. And that's what He urges us to do. The glass isn't just half full. This isn't the half full versus half empty model. No. This is the model that says my cup is overflowing. That's the thinking. Not, oh, I'm half full. Now, some of us might be kind of a half-empty kind of natural thinker, but I don't want to just become almost glass half-full thinker. No, because some people are kind of naturally that. He's not asking you to be that. He's asking you to be the thinker that says, my cup is overflowing. And I got more than I know. I'll ever need it more than that. So, remembering is with you, praying to him, talking with him always, thinking about the good, and being a doer. That's kind of the last part of what it is for. A lot of times it's missed when we look at some of the verses before it. And Paul, because Paul actually mentions, he said, you see me, what I do, you need to do it too. And then the Lord, then the God of comfort will provide for you, give you peace of mind. That's where it really comes from. Not only remembering and thinking and praying, but doing good. That really helps.